Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show and prove. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
I'm free to hug my family. I'm free to start over. This is the greatest day of my life. My heart is just bursting with gratitude. I want to thank President Donald John Trump. Woo!
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Donald Trump, and I approve this message.
Got another term on there, VGQ. What does that mean? Victims Guaranteed Qualification. Now, that keeps you from getting into arguments with other black people, particularly on television, which I get sick of that. Black people shouting, you know, we get into our ghetto thing once we get on television and get wound up, and we start all yelling at once. And the racists sit there smugly and just look. They watch the tennis match, so to speak, right? And black people are shouting each other down, talking about, you don't know what you're talking about, and so-and-so, and so-and-so, and we go into our Amos and Andy and Sapphire Act. Okay. VGQ means Victims Guaranteed Qualification. Guaranteed qualification to do what? To give your opinion on anything about race. Don't care what it is. If you're on there with Minister Farrakhan, or you're on there with Mike Tyson, or you're on there with Miss, what's her name, Williams, the lady that had him put in, you know, recommended that he be put in jail. Or you're on there with anybody. See, don't cut the other black person down. Now, I don't even like that term, brother and sister, even though it's been around for about 30 years. But I ain't going to talk about the brother here. And, you know, no. See, we haven't reached that stage where we can do that. See, we got to crawl before we walk, but we don't miss any steps. Don't say you are what you're not. Don't say you feel something that you don't really feel. You don't really feel that he's a brother. I usually use the expression, I don't like anybody in here. I say that to all audiences. I haven't been taught to like anybody. I've been taught to dislike people. I've been taught that. And then they're taught to dislike me, so it's just compounded disliking. I haven't even got to love yet. All right. So what we do is minimize conflict. Try not to hurt each other. So a certain thing, that's what a code is for. It's a stopgap. It keeps me from saying something against you. You say, well, don't you agree with what this person just said down here on the other end and whatnot? That person has VGQ, Mr. Donahue. I keep using him because he's one of the most prominent TV people. Right. But the main thing you do is try to stay off of a radio program or TV program or even a neighborhood stage program, you might say, where you spend your time shouting back and forth at other black people. Nothing is getting done there. And when it's done on television, a lot of black people just get up from the TV set and go on in the kitchen somewhere once that shouting starts. Yeah, they get disgusted. Say, you know, they say, oh, here we go. They started off okay, but now they are, you know, they're doing a job on each other, and I don't even want to hear it. So just don't do it. And you cut it off. The cutoff point is that person has Victims guaranteed qualification. You spell it out what it means. Meaning the person can say anything about race that they want to, and I can say anything about it that I want to. You are guaranteed that. You earn that as a victim. Simply by being a victim. Now, if a white person says something, that's something else.
Black brother in hell.
Context of white supremacy. Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Monday, February 3rd, 2020, so I have been told. Hopefully you are sober, not hungover from all the festivities, the ball game from yesterday evening, afternoon, I guess, depending on your part of the world. They said that in Toronto. I said that on the broadcast we did yesterday, simultaneous with the big game. The Prime Minister of Canada, Justin Trudeau, suspected race soldier, global system of white supremacy, said work on Monday is optional. Now, I didn't hear him say this directly, but they said this on Canadian television yesterday. So I guess they could be lying, but this was reported that the Prime Minister said that. Work optional. No, we're going to be watching the game, consuming a lot of alcohol, spirits, as they call it. Work on Monday optional. I suspect that if you are classified as non-white, you probably did not get a day off, a holiday, just to celebrate the triumphs of Patrick Mahomes, Kansas City Chiefs. Maybe I'm wrong. Anywho, broadcast, which, speaking of Super Bowl, that was the Donald Trump. I forgot the commercial before we did hear from Mr. Neely Fuller Jr., producejustice.com, but we did hear from our president, Donald J. Trump, his commercial that ran during the Super Bowl yesterday with a black female, Alice Johnson, in tears, thanking. Thank you, white man. Thank you, white man. Same thing I said yesterday. I don't have any problem, anything to say about that victim of racism, white supremacy, but I will say the same thing I said yesterday. That is absolutely tacky and trashy, and they had repeated instances of that. Whites, various whites, Donald Trump, Michael Bloomberg, grabbing some victim of racism to come out and, oh yes, report on how I have done so much to save you and other niggers. Yes, yeah, vote for me, vote for me. See how I've helped the coloreds? Vote for me. Absolutely distasteful, disgraceful, and there was a lot of that on display during the Super Bowl yesterday, 24 hours ago. Be that as it may, reading more important than watching television. Dr. Welsing used to say that regularly when she was a guest on the program. We have our book club every Thursday. We are reading medical. We are not reading Medical Apartheid. We already read that in the book club 2016. We read Medical Apartheid by Harriet A. Washington. We are reading A Terrible Thing to Waste, also by Harriet A. Washington. She might have two books in my top 10, which is amazing. I do not have any other repeat authors in my top 10 of books, and we have only read three chapters of A Terrible Thing to Waste. Looks like it will be in the top 10. I am stunned. Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Harriet A. Washington, once again, A Terrible Thing to Waste. Brilliant scholarship. Looking forward to continuing. That's it. We have been here 11 years since we returned to the air, February of 2009. 11 years of counter-racist broadcasting, interference with the CO.W.S. archives, disrupting our iTunes feed, disrupting other feeds where we upload our content. This has been going on for 11 years. There are a number of consistencies within that 11-year span that we have been back on the air. The most obvious, racist man, racist woman, racist child, still in charge throughout the known universe. Many other consistencies within that. One of the other consistencies within that 11-year tenure, disruption to the phone lines. That would be another one for listeners and Gus D alike. A third, consistency over that time period. Even in fact, it's more than 11 years. The cows started in 2007 at the University of Washington's radio station. We were thrown off the air within 2 months. It took a year and about 14 months, not quite a year and a half, for us to come back on the air in 2009, February of 2009. Since our 2007 inception, one consistency has been people who have requested to come on the Context of White Supremacy, it has not been for constructive purposes, almost without exception. I can even go back and give stories, some I'm not even sure if I've shared on the program, of how this has happened consistently throughout our tenure. So I've seen this not once, not twice, but many times. I said almost without exception. So one of the earliest instances of this, there was a black male, and I'm doing VGQ. I could give this victim's name, but it would not serve a constructive purpose, even though it should be stand by your work. Victim of racism, who lives in the Seattle area and has been here for a while. We met him. We would converse with him in the summer of 2007, literally weeks before the cows came into existence. We were sitting outside. It was a beautiful summer Seattle day, mid to late August, some of the best time to be in Seattle, warm and sunny weather, just amazing. We're sitting in Red Square at the University of Washington on the steps out in front of the Odegaard Library. This black male comes up behind us and he says, "What are you two niggers talking about?" Myself, back of the bus, the two originators of the Context of White Supremacy, myself, back of the bus, we look at each look at each other, and if you've seen the Boondocks, there is an episode where Uncle Ruckus is joking. He's talking to the local reporters, and he says, he's telling black people that you can come to the neighborhood and visit, hang out, where it's mostly white people. You can come hang out and visit, but just be gone by sundown, sundown towns, right? And he gives a big hearty laugh and he says, "Just joking, not really," as he's telling black people to be gone, you know, before it gets dark. So we had seen this episode, back of the bus and myself, we look at each other after this black male has asked us, "What are you two niggas talking about?" And he says, "What are you two niggas talking about?" And he says, "Just joking." Back of the bus and myself, we look at each other, start laughing and say, "Not really." Fast forward about 2 months, the cows exist. We've done our first couple of broadcasts and back of the bus is spearheading an effort to have a meeting for victims of racism to get together to exchange views on racism. This same black male, victim of racism that I just mentioned, "What are you two niggas talking about?" He says he wants to come to the meeting. So great, wonderful. The more the merrier. So he comes to the meeting, he exchanges views. There's a lot I can say about that. I think we talked about that on the archives way back before. But eventually he shares his reason for coming to the meeting is because, I'm paraphrasing, but basically he said, "You know, I just wanted to see what you niggas are talking about. You all are, you know, good for a few laughs. I'll come and laugh." It was like, oh, wow. I thought like you were coming to share a thought or two or something. And it's, oh, no, this is just, you know, ignorant black people. I'll just come and get a few laughs in. Like, she's like, oh, okay. Well, at least I'm glad to be informed of your perspective, which goes back to what I said from the beginning when it was, "What are you two niggas talking about? Just joking." And we looked at each other, "Not really." This was one person who requested to be a guest on the program. Now, we had other people. I said, it's been quite a few. I don't even think about replying or accepting when people ask at this point. I look at them with extraordinary suspicion because we don't have generally people are like, man, that Gus is my dude, and oh, I ride with the cows, and they help. That generally is not the case. It's generally more of the latter. So I'm very suspicious and unaccustomed to anyone coming with constructive purposes for, I would like to be on the cows. Now, we add that with, we have read a lot of books here at the Context of White Supremacy. Reading, more important than watching television. I like nonfiction books. I don't read a lot of fiction. I also am not a fan of the prison genre, books about prisons, books really about policing, prison, any of that. I've said that before on the program. Like, you know, I don't do programs to follow every police shooting. I have no interest in that at all. I've said that even though we have done some of those programs, that is not my interest. You're going to have all of those police incidents and problems as long as the system of white supremacy exists. Nothing can be done about that. Try to make sure it's not you. Do the best that you can developing your code to try to see that it's not you. But that thing, those type of police incidents of terrorism and trauma going to happen in the system of racism, white supremacy. That said, on prisons specifically, slightly different from just policing, we have also done a lot of programs, even though that's a subject matter that I don't really enjoy or find very pleasing, not my subject matter. Snitching, Criminal Informants and the Erosion of American Justice by Alexandra Natapoff, 2011, she was with us. We just read, live from death row, Mumia Abu-Jamal in our book club, D'Amico Booth, Black Male. He's written a number of books, Why Are So Many Black Men in Prison? He was with us 2011. Texas Tough by Robert Perkinson examines the history of the Texas penal system and how it's spread its influence throughout the so-called United States. Douglas Blackman, Suspected Racist, Slavery by Another Name, with us in 2010. Just some of the books that we've covered about the prison system, even though that's a subject matter that I don't really care for in terms of spending a whole lot of time and energy. The book that we are talking about today is about the prison system. I already said that's not really a subject matter I enjoy too much, but even more importantly, as I said, our guest for today's program requested to be a guest on the program, so I have my suspicion there, and I did not really enjoy this book. We'll be able to explore that as we proceed. But I wanted to be very clear with our listeners: this is not an endorsement from Gus T for this book, because I didn't even enjoy it. Had to make sure that that was explicitly stated, just for integrity's sake. This book is similar to Mumia Abu-Jamal. It mentioned some of the exact same subject matter as Mumia's Live from Death Row, which we just read. If you listen to the book club, I complained for a whole month about that book. I have been heavily influenced by Mumia Abu-Jamal, but I did not like Live from Death Row upon second reading, and I said I think it has aged poorly. I did not like this book either. In fact, I liked it less than Mumia Abu-Jamal, so it wouldn't even be any integrity for me to come and talk about a very similar book and go about it when I just spent a month saying that I did not enjoy Live from Death Row. And this is from an author who asked to be a guest on the cows, which is something I already said I would have suspicion about anyway. So this will be a conversation, interesting review of the book. People can ask questions. If anybody else has read the book, they can chime in and share their views. I'll pick out some of the portions from the book that gave me pause, made me think. Mr. Neely Fuller Jr. is mentioned directly in the book, which is always interesting. But this is not endorsed by Gus T. Renegade. I did not enjoy the book. Not quite the level of The Hate U Give, but I did not enjoy the book. We'll explore why. The book we are discussing, Georgia's Corrupt Prison System as Told by an Insider, a decade of time spent working in the Georgia penal system, flagrant racism, white supremacy on display. That's what Douglas Blackman's book is about, Slavery by Another Name, History of the Georgia Penal System, Racism, White Supremacy, largely focusing on Georgia, other areas as well. 2010, he was with us. Mr. Martin Dandridge, the author of the text, should be with us live. Mr. Dandridge, are you with us, sir?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
Crystal clear. You wrote the book, wanted to come on and chat about the text before we get into the book. I'm sure for some folks, this is their first time hearing about the book, Georgia's Corrupt Prison System. Any information that you would like to share with listeners about who you are, the work that you do?
Yes, I'm retired, 63 years old. I was a social worker and a case manager for about 30 years in Chicago. And I'll date myself a little bit. I was in Chicago when Fred Hampton and Mark Clark were assassinated. I was in Chicago when Mayor Daley really gave Martin Luther King problems in Chicago. I became familiar with Edward V. Hanrahan's men in Chicago. They were quick to pull out their pistols. He was the state's attorney at the time. I have a master's in inner city studies and a bachelor's in speech communications. The reason I wrote the book was I was trying to think of some way to prevent people from going into the prison system by just communicating my experiences and what happens in certain prison systems.
People from going to prison. Is that the primary reason that you wrote this book, Georgia's Corrupt Prison System, to prevent people from going to prison?
Yes.
Okay. That is good to know. I will keep that in mind, and listeners should keep that in mind as we read the book. You are a black male, is that correct?
Yes, 63-year-old black male. I'm a fraternal twin. My twin was married for a little bit of a time to a white woman. My sister is currently married to a white male. And myself, I am suspicious of all white people. I'm just, it's never seemed logical to be not suspicious of them. Whether at work, or whether at play, I don't have them come into my house unless there's some kind of business to do. And I don't hang out with them because I can find that there are, overall, from what I've been able to observe, a toxic people.
To get my Super Bowl question in before we get back on track, we were here yesterday discussing the big ball game. And I reflected, in prison, television is important, can be a big part of keeping control. You've got a large population, the guards, warden, you are greatly outnumbered by generally a lot of non-white people. Television can be super important, keep them entertained. And I said, even though I've not been in greater confinement, I guess my code has worked to that end thus far. But I have talked to a number of individuals who have been in greater confinement, and they have said, I think unanimously, that they were not deprived of the Super Bowl. Some of them even recalled wagering on the game while they were in greater confinement and collecting, I guess, on, you know, if they were successful. Maybe they picked the Chiefs yesterday and they were able to collect on their winnings. Mr. Dandridge, from your time, a decade in Georgia's penal system, were the inmates allowed the Super Bowl privileges?
Oh, yes, and there were smirks from many white officers about making sure that there wasn't a potential riot because they wanted to make sure they watched Soul Train also.
Consistent with what I've heard about Super Bowl, at minimum, this broadcast, racism, white supremacy, I use those terms as synonyms. I use the same definition for both terms. That definition is a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
From what I've been able to see when I've traveled, I've seen it everywhere in the world. I think that's an accurate definition. For myself, though, I pretty much keep it simple. My definition mission is that those white people that are in total control of non-white people. So I try to keep that in the upper parts of my mind when I step out the house in the morning and keep that available to myself to be vigilant on, that I have to have my shield on understanding that.
Okay. Again, Mr. Martin Dandridge, Georgia's Corrupt Prison System, as told by an insider. This book was published first in 2007, is that correct?
Yes, yes, 13 years ago.
Okay. I said Mr. Neely Fuller Jr. is mentioned in your text. Have you read the United Independent Compensatory Code System concept?
Oh, I read that about 30 years ago.
Okay. So this is like in the 90s? That would that be accurate, approximately?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, matter of fact, I remember it starkly because I was visiting some relatives in San Francisco, and there was a bookstore there, and I saw that book. I had been meaning to get it. So it's the long version of the big book, not the code. And I was I read that book so much, it became decrepit. It's just the leaves are just falling off the pages. Because I was highlighting certain things to keep in mind and questions to answer, and it really piqued my interest.
Okay.
I also liked Dr. Frances Chris Welsing. I read her book, and I've enjoyed her analysis on it, in addition to Amos N. Wilson. He's always been a psychologist that really piqued my interest with his book, Black on Black Crime. And black-on-black violence and his analysis that we live in a crimogenic society just based on crime. So, and it's not going to change because it was founded on crime, and the people that commit the crimes aren't going to stop.
Okay. I'm just reminding listeners, that's why this program will sound a little different, because normally a program like this wouldn't have happened. Generally, if someone had requested to be on the program, I wouldn't have even thought about accepting it. Especially if they requested multiple times, which was the case for our guest today. Now, if I had someone requested to be a guest on the program, and then they said they're familiar with Mr. Fuller's work, they've read his book, as he said, enough times that the pages are falling apart, I've highlighted, I would say, oh, okay, let's see if that's reflected in the book. In my view, that is not the case, although that is not surprising. That's been something that I've observed for a long time. People will say, they'll mention Dr. Welsing, they'll mention Mr. Fuller. In fact, I gave this example, I think, minutes before we went live. I've heard this many, many times. People will say, Mr. Fuller read his work, or I've heard him, listened to him. He's had a great influence on my thinking and how I understand white supremacy, racism. And then they'll come right behind that and they'll say, brother and sister, America treats black people unfairly. It'll be lots of things. And again, it's VGQ. We certainly do not all have to come out and parrot the exact verbiage of Mr. Fuller or Amos Wilson or anybody else, Gus T. Renegade, anybody else. However, accurately articulating the system of racism, white supremacy is at the core, more so than verbatim repetition. Accurate articulation of racism, white supremacy is important. When I hear people who say that Mr. Fuller has greatly influenced their, or in any way influenced their understanding of racism, white supremacy, I pay attention to contradictions. If they say that and they're name calling, I take note. If they say that and they are not very accurate or not very precise with their use of words in discussing the problem of racism, white supremacy, I take note. I would take a special note of that for someone to request to be a guest on the COW.S, knowing we stumble and fumble in that same direction about being precise with the way that we talk about racism, white supremacy. This book is not precise in the way that it talks about racism, white supremacy, like at all. It does not reflect someone who has went through it. If I read this book, if you said, based on what you see in this book, does this look like, or does this read like, the author has greatly studied Mr. Fuller's work, highlighted it until the pages are falling apart, I would say, well, if that's the case, it's not reflected on these pages. We can either go through this as we are reading, because I have pages and things where I can read to give examples, or I can give you a chance to respond now, and then we can still do that. Do you want to respond now?
Oh, like I said, it wasn't just something focused on Mr. Fuller, period. It was just something that I wanted to put what they had, and I've been influenced by Malcolm X's autobiography also. So, and he's in there. I thought that was the information I decided to put in there. And I'm very open for criticisms. That's how you learn.
Still learning myself. Why did you want to discuss Georgia's corrupt prison system on the context of white supremacy?
Basically, I've listened to the show a lot. I've listened to it. And that's... I rarely get on a radio show. I'm very a quiet, reserved person, but it inspired me to call. I haven't been on a radio show, requested to be on a radio show, and I'm pretty much a person that's observes and quiet. I'm not looking to get on a book tour or anything like that. Like I said, I wrote it to help the community, hopefully.
Much obliged. Just pointing out, and I guess we've been here 11 years. I certainly do not expect that every single person who is listening to the COWS has been listening for 11 years, or, you know, would be able to go back and catch up with 11 years of content. That is absurd. But I do think we try to make an effort to be consistent about, be precise with words. What we say is very important. Mr. Dandridge, he was talking about Mr. Fuller before, and I said, this is common. This, I hear this with many, many victims of racism. They say Mr. Fuller has influenced them, and even just in the response we just got, community, unfair. Very common. I think Mr. Fuller has talked for many years, and unfortunately, we have on the COWS as well, and we have failed, obviously. You can't have a community system of racism, white supremacy, or rather, the only people who have a community are white. And in the usage of the word fair, that's something that we've talked about on this program. Mr. Fuller has in the word guide. I don't know if it's in the original version, but I know that's something that he's talked about for quite a bit, usage of the word fair. There's more of that in the book. Getting to the text, you talk about how you came to work for the Department of Corrections and some of the nepotism, racism that you experienced in your 10-year tenure working for the Peach State prison system. Can you talk, because I think you said you and your wife both ended up being employed there for a time. How did the both of you all end up being employed there?
Well, first, they needed a counselor at Georgia State Prison. They needed a black female in the mental health part of the prison, specifically. So she was hired, and we decided to move down there next to the prison in Reidsville, Georgia. It was a very small town, and I was hired later, like, 3 months later. They needed a counselor for the prisoners that were HIV positive. So that's how I got down there. Plus, they had a house down there that all you had to do was pay utilities. So I figured, we decided that we agreed upon we could save some money and rent out our house in Lithonia, Georgia. And that worked out quite well for us.
Economic planning, I respect that. I remember that portion in the book in terms of why your wife was willing to do this. You don't have to pay a whole lot, and you can rent out your property where you can save some coins. Mr. Fuller talks quite a bit, time and energy, and economics, being frugal. Save those coins. Save those coins. Race soldiers like to do things to destabilize us. So if you can find opportunities to save, that is always encouraged. I made note you all had to do training. Let me pause here. How can I say training and not mention we have Neutralizing Workplace Racism every Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. If you have problems in the workplace, that is the time. Call in. We attempt to use logic. A lot of that involves being precise with words, too. Using logic to solve problems without creating new problems. Workplace racism every Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. But you talked about having to do training when you and your wife were starting out at the prison system. And some of the training sessions you mentioned were in Forsyth County. And some of the folks, they said they would either stay in town or they would go to Atlanta, do some of the nightlife in the area. And you said, hey, we're you and your wife were comfortable just staying here. We can do some reading, quiet evenings together, have the children come in, reading more important than watching television. But is that correct? You all were in Forsyth County for the training, Forsyth County, Georgia?
Yes. Yes, in Forsyth, the one that is the Forsyth, the city of Forsyth, when you're going toward Macon, that's the Forsyth. Not the one in Cummings. There's two different ones.
Oh, okay. Is this
the
area where they infamous Sundown Town for keeping out black people? Is this the same Forsyth, Georgia, or?
There's a different one. Yeah, I think the Forsyth you're talking about is when Hosea Williams went up there and they were throwing bricks at him and everything. No, there was a different one. But Forsyth City there in Monroe is a pretty, they're a pretty racist town there too.
A global system.
Matter of fact, they're not. Yeah, they're not that. I think there was it was a bridge murder there where four black people were shot to death down there. The Moore's Crossing Bridge, I believe it was, where in that area where it was never solved, and the people, one was pregnant, and they were both couples, and they were shot to death by white people in the 40s.
Yeah, we were just talking about that a few weeks ago with a white author. You talked about a number of times, workplace racism in a variety of different episodes. You gave one example of having plane tickets you'd already purchased, non-refundable, and then they come in and say, oh, no, we're not going to approve your time off. And you had to go talk to the warden. Oh, in fact, wait a minute. Your wife encouraged you to go talk to the warden because they had denied and said, nope, sorry, you'll just have to eat it. And, you know, tough luck on your, you know, tickets or what have you. What I said, it just said about racist mess up your plans. And your wife, isn't it true? She was the one that encouraged you to go talk to the warden to try to fight this.
That's correct.
Okay. And so you went to talk to the warden. What happened?
He basically said, there's no problem. You can do it. So it was just the chief counsel. That was his personal decision that he had made, like a unilateral decision. So I thank my wife for telling me to do that.
Workplace racism, neutralizing workplace racism every Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Sometimes it might be a matter of going to the more powerful white person to see if you can get the issue resolved with the less powerful white people who had denied your request, were trying to make you miss your plane trip. Was there any resentment amongst them since you, what they say, went over their head to go talk to the warden?
Oh, yes, there was some resentment. As a matter of fact, my second daughter, Imani, was born down in that area. So this same racist made a... My wife had sickle cell, so she was having to take off work. So he made some kind of smart remark about that. We were in the office, in his office. So I said, what did you say? And then he said, I didn't say anything. So it's like he backed down after that.
Context of white supremacy. Frequently encouraged not doing a whole lot of chatting about family and what have you in the workplace. That's what type of remark, attitude, I would expect racist man, racist woman, racist child. You on page 29 write, the prison industrial complex is advancing toward the continued uneven incarceration of black people. Crime is one thing and unjust lockup rates are definitely another. However, this need not be a hopeless situation. Some of our most productive leaders went to prison at some time or another. They include Malcolm X, Geronimo Pratt, Steve Biko, Huey P. Newton. I'll stop there. You list some others. What is your definition of a leader?
A person that is ready to take consequences for their decisions and know that it can happen to you. They can also be willing to follow also. It's not just that person. It's just saying, okay, if something happens to me, then somebody else can step in. So I found these individuals to have made the ultimate sacrifices. And that is my definition of a leader. You have to be kind of like a foot soldier, willing to pass the baton to the next person, not the sole and only leader.
This is not the compensatory call-in, but people who do listen should note, we do talk about metaphors a lot, pass the baton, foot soldiers, metaphors, lots of metaphors. Can a leader be subject to the system of white supremacy?
Oh, yes, we're all subject to the system of white supremacy. If we're non-white, everybody, me, you, everybody.
Okay. Again, I'm just going back to what was said at the beginning about the amount of time you spent studying Mr. Fuller's work. I've heard Mr. Fuller say pretty regularly that all of the leaders of black people are white. And I've heard him say that consistently with emphasis because that is important. I go back to understanding some of the fundamentals. That is one of the reasons that we, in my view, have not solved this problem. We are still confused, and we do not accurately articulate the problem of white supremacy, racism. When Mr. Fuller says all of the leaders of black people are white, following counter-racist logic, these individuals, Geronimo Pratt, Steve Biko, Huey P. Newton, Nelson Mandela, some of these folks were in greater confinement for decades, almost three decades. It would be difficult to be, in my view, if you're in greater confinement, how can you lead? I think that's what was said of Nelson Mandela. How can you lead? You're in greater confinement. You can't even make decisions about what you're going to do with your genitals, much less, dictate what's going to happen with an Nkontuwe Sizwe. Counter-racist logic. And I think he does that so that we get out of being inaccurate with how much power we have, expectations that we have placed on other people for what they can't do in a system of racism, white supremacy, and understanding truthfully racism, white supremacy, what does that mean? And ultimately, who is in charge? Who are our quote unquote leaders? Just like I said, when someone asks to be a guest on the Cows, I have much more suspicion, and then I pay much more attention to discrepancies with things not matching up. But again, a lot of these are very, very common. These sort of discrepancies are common in general. When I speak to victims of racism, they'll say they love Dr. Welsing and then proceed to name call, or they love Mr. Fuller and, America doesn't treat black people fairly. Very common. Next, you said, or in fact, we'll do, have you heard the term greater confinement? Are you familiar with that
term? Yes, I have.
Okay. What does the term greater confinement mean to you?
It means you're already in prison right now, but if you do something to get yourself put in a greater confinement prison, like a jail, or a closed security prison, that means greater confinement. I must also say that I do not agree with everything Mr. Fuller says. So there will be some differences in what I think. When he says the code, there's some things I don't totally agree with. You know, I don't read somebody's work and then just say, okay, I'm going to agree with everything. I have questions, and I get the basics of the work, but I don't parrot everything that Mr. Fuller said, because I don't agree with everything. But I think that his book is monumental as far as getting particularly black people to understand how to stay away from the confusion, I think.
Context of White Supremacy. You on 52. Right, though it is not being communicated through the media as fervently as black criminalization, white females are becoming very viable, of fitting the typical profile of child molesters, and seem to have no problem justifying this behavior. In more than a few cases, they have babies by the children they abuse. Furthermore, they have gone so far as to legalize it through marriage. This lack of moral boundaries is not new. Looking at how these cases are being handled, one cannot help seeing the leniency applied. This sends an encouraging signal to future offenders. Yet it is another glaring example of a criminal justice system showing white preference while claiming victimization when compensation is given to black people for evil deeds committed against blacks in the past. This was written in 2007. What are your observations 13 years later on white women and their crimes, particularly child molestation and the like, from 2020?
I would say it's increased even more with the technology and the idolation of white women. They can do no wrong. This perception of that, this false perception of it, I would say it's even gotten worse. I'll give you one example. When I was working for the prison system, it was this elderly looking white lady. I guess people that looked at her, she was in prison. People that looked at her was, oh, this is this sweet white woman. Basically, I read her file, read her jacket. Basically, what this woman did was murder her husband. And she said, well, before the Olympics came, you had Techwood Homes over in Atlanta. So it was a crime area. A lot of black people lived there. So she had her husband killed, and they parked his dead body in the trunk over in Techwood Homes, hoping that some black person would mess with the vehicle. Fortunately, nobody ever touched the vehicle, and they were able to investigate and find out what she had done, which her whole purpose was to blame it on the black person. So I found them to be very calculating and very, if I had to pick between the two, they're equally yoked, white males and white females. I think that just because they cry and all of that kind of thing, or they can be more refined and try to act friendly, I found them to be very, very toxic and vicious in their follow-up. And if 2020 is any indication, I would say it's gotten worse.
And worse. No progress made. Before I proceed with the white woman, if folks have questions, the number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Before I get back to the white woman, Mr. Fuller's concept of greater confinement, do you think that's logical? Him saying that all non-white people, if you are subject to the system of racism, white supremacy, you're already in prison. It just, you know, is a matter of how confined you are. Some of us have more room to move about than others. Is that accurate? Is that logical?
Well, I would say it's very logical, because let's take like the passport, for instance. All of Americans, I think there was a study done that said less than 20% of Americans total of any nationality has a passport. So if you do not have a passport, you're already limited there. Some people think, okay, America's the greatest place to be, and I don't need a passport. But that limits people right there. You can also get into greater confinement in a negative way, I would say. And I find myself, I have to screen people that I'm around, check who I'm around. Because if somebody else is doing some things that can get put in prison, I could go along right with them. I have to give you an example. I used to play tennis with this guy and enjoyed playing tennis. I observed that couldn't really get a real feel of where he worked at. He was always driving different cars, had a lot of money. It was just too many red flags for me to continue to hang around with this person. So I had to stop that interaction with him. So at 63 years of age, I still have to screen people to make sure that I don't get put in greater confinement. Doesn't mean that I'm downing anybody or anything like that. But, and I also have to, I have a rule about alcohol. I make sure when I get in my vehicle, just me personally, I'm not saying anybody else can do it, that I have no alcohol at all in my system when I'm getting ready to drive. There's nothing, not one piece of alcohol in my system at the time. That's just my rule. If I'm going to do something like that, I just stay at home. I'm not going to get behind the wheel for whatever reason with alcohol in my system. You can be put in confinement because of that.
With greater confinement, you said that was logical in terms of what Mr. Fuller laid out. is that a term that you use? Because I didn't see that term used in the book. Is that a term that you use in talking about racism, or is that a term that you thought, I don't need to include this term in the book, or was it a conscious choice in not using that term in the text?
It was a conscious choice on my part.
Oh, okay. Because
my view of it was that it wasn't needed to put it in there. That's why I chose not to put it in there.
Okay. Getting back to white women, on page 59, you talk about nepotism. Again, we have workplace racism. Neutralizing workplace racism. Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. You're on 59, nepotism. You write, these type of shenanigans were all too common in Georgia's prison system. Bobby Whitworth was once commissioner of the Georgia Department of Corrections and eventually transferred to the parole board after bungling the department's follow-up on sexual abuse at Milledgeville. Wow. When I was at Georgia State Prison in Reidsville, then Commissioner Whitworth shook hands with me while visiting the prison. I did not know that much about him. I was more familiar with Newsom. I worked with his daughter, Leslie Newsom, at Rockdale DeKalb Probation Detention Center. According to my recollection, she had a college degree in criminal justice and emphasized that her acquiring the probation officer position at the center had nothing to do with her father. Do you think that's true?
Oh, no. Don't think that was accurate at all. I just listened to her. I didn't say anything. I knew it was altogether different. Matter of fact, after her father left the Department of Corrections, he started his own, I believe it was a security consultant. And he made about $1.5 million. So he made money off of that after he became a left the department with only a high school education.
Very, very common system of racism, white supremacy. Let me make sure I'm not making an assumption. Leslie Newsom, is this someone who would be classified as a white woman, Leslie Newsom?
Yes.
Okay. And I think that's important because you said that, hey, I don't think this is accurate. Maybe she does have a criminal justice degree and all that. And maybe she's got five more degrees since this was book was published 13 years ago. That could be true. And there's still some nepotism because my father works here. And even if I got these degrees from Trump University, now default, not accredited. Oh, well, I'm still going to get my jobs and promotions. That's why we have neutralizing workplace racism on Fridays. This is very, very common. But I also think this is important. This is on page 59 in the chapter, Good Old Boys. Just in terms of being precise with language, if Leslie Newsom is a white woman, and you talked about other females working at the prison, if she's benefiting, then good old boys is not even accurate terminology in describing this. And this is very, very common because it suggests white supremacy racism is operating by white men. And 2020, particularly what we just said about the child molestation and all the rest of it, you don't have a system of white supremacy racism without white women, white men working together jointly. Mr. Fuller talks about this in detail, as do a number of other black people. We on the COWS many, many times, and encouraging victims to not use terms like good old boys or old boys network that, again, leave out 50% of who is causing the problem in the known universe, the Leslie Newsoms. Continuing on 59, the advancement of Kenny Whitworth, the son of Bobby Whitworth, within the department appears to be less likely the result of qualifications. In July 1996, Kenny was promoted from parole investigator to parole officer, a position that ever since 1970 required a four-year college degree. At the time of the hire, Kenny had completed only 2 years of college. However, he was allowed to take the position because just 1 month earlier, the board, which included Kenny's father, Bobby, relaxed the requirement for a degree. As his star continued to rise, Kenny, in April 1999, was named by the board's chairman to a management position, paying him $45,678 a year, almost $20,000 more than the average parole officer. This position, you're supposed to have a four-year degree, 2 years. Good old Kenny. He was super qualified, I'm sure. Was this an anomaly? What, like, was this an odd happenings? Like, were you able to go in and apply with just a high school degree or a GED and move right on up the ladder, get all kinds of promotions and salaries and things?
Oh, no. No, they were. For specific people, especially if you were white.
Was there, I guess, any conflict, any of your coworkers? Do you remember anybody speaking up and saying, hey, this Kenny fella, I don't think he's even qualified. Like, are we sure he's capable? I mean, it seemed like safety would be a concern. Like, you wouldn't want to be promoting people in a prison. You already mentioned they might riot if we can't see the Chiefs win the Super Bowl. I mean, we got to make sure that we got competent staff. Did you hear any concerns about making sure that you got a qualified candidate who's going to be holding these positions?
Oh, there was talk about it, but the bottom line, when the decision was made, Kenny got the position.
You said in the book there was an effort to get, to get some sort of legislation or laws passed to try to minimize this type of nepotism. People, you know, hooking up their sons, daughters, nephews, whatever it is, hooking them up with a job and maybe easing some of the having some discretion about the requirements. Maybe they get enforced. Maybe they're not. You said that they were not able to get any type of laws or legislation passed about this.
To my knowledge, to this very day, I believe Roy Barnes tried to do it when he was governor, but nepotism is not illegal in Georgia with the state.
Generally, in the system of white supremacy, as long as it is a racist man, racist woman, taking care of another racist man or racist woman or racist child, that is about the size of it. That is what you are supposed to be doing. Doesn't matter if they're quite. That's the whole college admission scam. We just got finished talking about all of that. In the book, write quite a bit about racism and sharing some personal tidbits about your family with Mary Dunn. I guess if you could share with listeners who Mary Dunn is and how racism, white supremacy impacted her life and the care that she received.
Basically, my wife was working at a place after she left the department called Hillside, and Mary was staying there. And Mary was always talking with her, and she got a good rapport with Mary. And when Lauren was there, she wouldn't act out or anything. But when Lauren wasn't there, she would act out a lot. So one time they had a tendency at Hillside for the black people and people of color to, if they acted a certain way, to send them to Georgia Regional. It's a more of a confined place in Georgia Regional Hospital. It's more of like a prison mental health hospital. So they put Mary in there. So we went to see Mary, and we talked with her, and she told us, if y'all let me stay with y'all, I won't cause y'all any problems. So it touched us. So we decided to adopt Mary. And that was just an example of how even in mental health hospitals, racism can be a terrible thing. I worked briefly speaking on that subject at Georgia Regional about a year ago for about a month. And it was as much as I could take because they were still doing electric shock on people at Georgia Regional with all these people with degrees saying, oh, let's go to, okay, to shock them up. And that was very disheartening.
Even or medical apartheid, I did mention we are reading currently A Terrible Thing to Waste, but we previously read Medical Apartheid, and certainly talking medical care, white supremacy, racism, all nine areas of people activity. Let's see, I will. I'm trying to decide if I want to get some of our listeners or get to one more question. Check to see. Make sure we don't get piled up with listeners. The number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let's see. Thomas in New York, did you have a question for Mr. Martin Dandridge? You should be with us.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, Gus.
Hello.
I just wanted to know, who do you think is, if you had to choose, more dangerous as far as maintaining the system of racism, white supremacy, white men or white women?
Just from my assessment and my research, I would say the white female is more treacherous. They're both treacherous, but I would say the white female. I was kind of interesting to me on the white female subject when, I guess, Patrick Mahomes won the Super Bowl. He had his white woman there, but I noticed before the Super Bowl, they didn't show her at all. I don't remember seeing, like, they shoot a shot at the girlfriends or wives of people. They didn't show that at all before the Super Bowl, but I thought that was interesting. I would say that's more treacherous. As some examples, the Susan Smith situation, where she said a black man did it. The weeping white woman, their calculatingness is just something to be suspicious about at all times to me. It's the white female. The white male isn't far behind, but I would say the white female.
Okay. And I believe at the beginning, Gus had mentioned that you had a twin brother. You might have mentioned yourself that you had a twin brother who's married to a white woman and a sister who was married to a white male.
Brother was married to a white woman. They got divorced. Now he's with a black woman. So there was some, it's not something that I didn't think wouldn't happen, because he would tell me about some of the racist things her brother would say when he took him over there. So I'm thinking to myself and trying to let him know, She's not that far from what they are. And so it got to a point where they were having some type of heated argument, and she called them the N-word, and it's like, what did you expect? Wow. My sister is still currently married to a white man, and I'm very suspicious of him. You know, they've been married the whole time. She hasn't told me any type of abuse that he's done, but I'm still suspicious. Abuse and white people go hand in hand, so just because he's married to my sister does not mean he's beyond suspicion.
Absolutely. My last question, when working in the prison, I don't know if you're familiar with Khalif Browder's story, and even to another extent, if you saw the docuseries on Central Park 5 of Corey Wise, did you have to work with criminals or inmates who were in solitary confinement, and have you seen the effect that that had on them?
Yes, I had some that when I was working with HIV prisoners, some of them got put into what they called, their solitary confinement was called it was the same thing as solitary confinement, but it was called a special management unit. And it was terrible to be in there during the summer months because in that building, the rest of the prison was air conditioned, but in SMU, it was no air conditioning in there, and you could just, it would be hard to breathe there. And they only, they had something like 23 and a half hours in the cell, and then they get out a half an hour to do exercise. And included into that was you taking a quick shower and that type of thing. So you see a lot of people that would, they would really get discouraged, and then they would get angry. And one of the common things was if an inmate in SMU thought that they weren't being treated fairly, they would take some feces and stir it up and let it ferment a while with urine and throw it on a staff person. So when it ferments like that, that can like really burn your face like acid. So yes, I've seen the SMU in solitary confinement was a very negative experience for people that were put over there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Gus.
Much obliged.
Thank you.
Much obliged, Thomas, in New York. 206. 31, excuse me, wow, messed that up completely. 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Martin Dandridge, author, Georgia's Corrupt Prison System. Let's see. You, in the book, you use the term community quite a few times. Have you heard Mr. Fuller's commentary about you can't have a community and be subject to the system of white supremacy racism?
Yes, I've heard him say that, but I don't agree with that part.
What's your definition of a community?
People in a struggle, trying to make a better way where they're living. You can have a dysfunctional looking community, but I really don't agree with that term. So I think we do have communities as dysfunctional as they may be at any time.
Well, I just want to make sure I get the definition of your definition of community again. You said a group of people in a struggle. What was it?
A struggle, and they're living in a close proximity. Okay. And they're struggling against white supremacy. I believe they still have a community. Okay. That's one of the other ways where I disagree with Mr. Fuller on. I also, my view is I don't think I'll live to see this white supremacy eradicated, but it is my part of my struggle to keep at it and having the will to keep fighting against it. I don't think I'll live to see it, though.
Hmm. So, according to your definition, if we were on the same hall in a death row unit, we would be a group of people together in a struggle, and we're working against racism, white supremacy, that would be a community?
No, that's a different interpretation. I'm thinking about, I'm talking about a free world situation, not in a prison.
Greater that confinement.
Not in greater confinement.
Greater confinement.
That would be a community,
okay,
in my opinion.
Okay, so that is not a community. So we would have to be outside of prison, and then it could be a group of people in a struggle working together against racism. That is a community? Yes? Is that, am I accurate?
Yes, okay. That can be. Yes, yes, sir.
Okay. Even a court, well, if it's that, because see, with that, you included the part about it's a group of people working together against racism. I am not aware. Now, if anybody knows the geographic location anywhere in the known universe where there are black people in like a group, like there's a whole like neighborhood or town, and they are working together as best they can against racism. Wow. Like, I don't know of where that place is. If you know of such a location, make sure you star 61. The email is untiljustice@gmail.com. You are in Atlanta, is that right?
Correct.
Man, you live in a community by your definition?
Yes, sir.
The black people, like the black people on your street, are actively engaged against racism?
I can't say all of them are, but
that's,
for the most part, I would say yes.
For the most part. I would need to come hang out and see. And you're in Atlanta?
I was in Atlanta, but now I'm in Duluth, Georgia.
Okay. I will have to come back and hang out. I lived in Atlanta, and for the most part, the victims of racism, white supremacy that I worked with, lived with, and was around on a regular basis, they were not actively engaged in working against racism at all. They might have talked about racism from time to time, which is very common, but they were not doing anything about racism, white supremacy. They're not even talking about it in an accurate manner for the most part. So that is a stat. If we have any people where you can truthfully say that most of the black people, most of the non-white people that you live around, they are working against racism as best they can, dial in. I have not found that to be the case. Use the term racial prejudice in the book as well. Do you think that's a more accurate description of what we have if you're describing the prison industrial complex or any of the other vestiges of what we've been talking about? Do you think racial prejudice is a more accurate term than white supremacy?
I would say white supremacy is more accurate. That would be more accurate than that term.
Okay. Let's see. You said that your book was about preventing, well, the primary objective with your book was about preventing people from going to prison. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. Do you have specific strategies? Because I don't remember that specifically, that not victims of racism can employ that would help to keep them from going to prison?
Let's see. It should be in the conclusion, starting on page 127, is preventive methods. And it starts from there on.
Yeah, that is. How do you, number five, thank you. Number five, Chancellor Williams' Component Division of Intelligence and Security, as stated in The Destruction of Black Civilization, we did a book study on that, should be considered as an option for community protection. How, there's that word again. Do you all have that? Well, you said you do. You said you live in a spot where, for the most part, the people there are working against racism. Do you all have this community intelligence set up? Do you have this division? The component division of intelligence and security. Do you all have that?
I would say it isn't. I would say no. So that's why preventive methods is there. So hopefully we can get it at some time.
That's
something similar to it.
That would make me a little bit suspicious. If you live someplace, Mr. Dandridge, and you say for the most part the black people there are doing what they can to work against racism, that's unusual in a very constructive way. If that's the case, it would seem like, you know, getting some sort of security detail together, like 3, 4, 5 people. That George Zimmerman was doing that by himself, right? Like, you could get 5 people together to say, hey, this is important. What's been the obstacle? Like, have you tried to get this, make sure I get it right, the component division of the intelligence security? Have you done specifically to try to get that going? And if not, what's been like the biggest obstacle to getting that going?
I would say just people not feeling comfortable enough with doing that. The most comfort a lot of times you get is I'll just encourage a person, if there's anything that seems out of the way, I'll call 911.
Okay. Do you all have the number 2 is community imposed curfews for teens. This will take proactive involvement from families in the community. There's that word again repeatedly. Do you all have the community imposed curfews?
Now, those are working good. Teens don't stay out late with those. Yes, you have people observing those because you're going for your walks and things like that, and you're observing if teens are past curfew when they shouldn't be out. So that seems to work well.
What's the community, what's the time, I guess, when teens should be inside?
I would say no later than 11 p.m.
11 p.m. for teens. He said that one is constructive, and they got that implemented. I guess that's one folks can try, or I guess if you are fortunate to be in that sort of environment that's super constructive, if you have these self-imposed curfews for teens, share. Let us know how that's going. If not, maybe see if you can get that implemented. Self-imposed curfews. I know Dr. Cambon talks about not being out super late, that is not, best in a system of white supremacy racism. Frequently, a lot of bad things happen when it is late in the evening. Anything else in terms of strategies that can be employed to stay out of greater confinement? We got 5, including the component division, which seems like a difficult one to get rolling. So at least we got 4 others. So there anything else in terms of preventive measures to keep black people out of greater confinement?
I would say, I didn't put it in a book, but I would say constantly being vigilant about the media as far as making it seem like it's glamorous to go to prison. If you are a hip hop artist, or what type of artist to have some credibility to go to prison, and it's just not a good situation. I'll give you an example. There was a young 13-year-old man, a young 13-year-old teenager. His name was called Little B. And what happened to Little B is, a father with his wife had stopped at a convenience store, and his headlights were on. Little B happened to be doing something with some drugs, and he thought told the guy to turn off the headlights. The guy didn't hear. So what ended up happening was Little B shot the guy. He ended up going to prison. Little B was put in Lee Arundel prison. It's a very vicious prison for a teenager to be put in. I had read the file, and what happened to Little B is they raped him so bad that he ended up with a colostomy bag, unfortunately. So that's, going to prison is nothing to be looking forward to, or something to be proud of, to show that you're tough. If it's 10 of them and one of you, you're going to get raped. I don't care how big you are.
We have Mr. Martin Dandridge, the number 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. If you have questions, go ahead and get your hand up. Do not lollygag. Caller, oh, this is Imhan DC. Imhan DC, if you had a question for Mr. Dandridge, you should be with us.
Yes, sir. Greetings. And greetings, Mr. Dandridge.
Hello.
Yes, sir. I just had two questions. The first question is, how can we end white supremacy in the shortest time frame possible? And my second question is, what is the shortest possible time frame to end white supremacy?
Both of those questions, I am not in a position to answer either one of those questions. All I can say is I don't know. I really don't know what is the shortest time to complete it. If I had to say shortest time and how you would do it, it would be how the white people going to stop it, because they can stop it right away. But since they're not going to stop it, that would be the only one I could think of off the right now. But as far as it stopping in some type of date and time, at this point, I really don't have the answer to it.
Thank you. Well, my last, if I could ask the last question, is what's your definition of white supremacy?
Sure.
And that's all. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. My definition is those white people that are in total control of non-white people. That's my definition.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Groovy. Other folks, if you have a question for Mr. Dandridge, you should get your hand up. Much obliged. Thank you for not lollygagging. Next 5 minutes or so, caller at 2045. Did you have a question for Mr. Dandridge? Did you have a question?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Sorry, I apologize for that. Hello, greetings, Gus, and the callers and the guests.
Hello.
I just wanted to ask you a quick question, because you made a point earlier that you're suspicious around all white people, and which I agree. Have you ever personally been in an intimate relationship with a white woman?
No.
You have not? Okay.
Not ever.
As far as the okay. And the relationship that you say your siblings have had with the white man and white woman, did you witness any blatant white supremacy or racism in any one of those relationships?
I wasn't around them that much to observe it, but I observed it secondhand, for like when my brother told me she eventually called him the N-word. So that was, you know, it came from him. So I said, well, doesn't surprise me. That was my view.
And he's still with this white woman?
No, he divorced her. Now he's with a black woman.
Okay, okay. Thank you for taking my call, Gus, and peace to everybody.
Take care.
Much obliged, good sir. 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you have a question. Get your hand up right now if you think you have a question you would like to get in. On page 97, Killing Authority, You write, the annihilation of black people is an issue worldwide. That is why it is important for us to build stronger ties with Africa. We are not just American blacks, but Africans living in America. As Africans, our brothers and sisters in the mother, our brothers and sisters, confused me, in the motherland, have the right to put pressure on America in its mistreatment of us. How does America mistreat us? And who are you talking about when you say America's mistreatment of us?
When I say America, I'm talking about basically white America. How they mistreat us. They kill us on the street every day. We're not giving proper medical care. We're abused on jobs. The list goes on and on and on. I've heard that Ghana is accepting African Americans there to their country. I don't view this country as the end all. Like I said, I don't see anything wrong with having dual citizenship. Citizenship in another country and citizenship here. Two passports. So the abuse, and I don't think the abuse is going to end either, because there's too many benefits from it. But I think it will end eventually, because we will make it happen. Even though there's no time frame, there has to be a will to keep on doing this and eradicate it.
Context of white supremacy. Did you read the portion of Mr. Fuller's code book where he says he gives the definition for an American is someone who practices justice? Do you remember that portion of the code book?
I don't agree with that, the term. My view is America is the same as white. If you really want to look at it, America, that's why I don't believe we're citizens here. We're not treated like citizens. You can say American, African American, all you want, but we're not a citizen here. To me, America is synonymous with white. That's why Trump is always saying, make America great again, which is synonymous with white. Make white people in America great again, like the good old days.
But what about the black people? Because I think what I just read, maybe I have been retarded. Let me see. The annihilation of black people is an issue worldwide. That is why it's important for us to build stronger ties with Africa. And then it goes on. But if the annihilation of black people is an issue worldwide, if we're using terms like America's mistreatment of black people, that is suggesting that racism, white supremacy is an American thing, as opposed to this is global, coordinated effort. This is not tied to one specific geographic location. Does that seem logical?
Yes. I was just talking there on a national sense, U.S. as opposed to the global. Yes, that's accurate what you just said.
Even with the phrasing, though, with what you just said, that you were talking on a national level, that would be. But the way this is worded, saying America's mistreatment of us is, I mean, some people use the term America. Some people, I mean, you understand, everyone does not think,
yes,
America,
correct,
white. Some people think America and they think a mass of land. It's just, I think what I said before, not precise. It's not a very precise way of even articulating what you said, that you're talking about the global system of white supremacy, racism, but on a national scale, this sentence doesn't even do an efficient job of articulating that.
I can see your point there.
Okay. Anybody else? Questions? Comment? They want to make sure they get in. Mr. Dandridge, author, Georgia's Corrupt Prison System, as told by an insider. I assume they're good. You use black men, black women in the book on a pretty regular basis as well. Mr. Fuller talks about, or he says pretty consistently, the only men, the only women on the planet are classified as white. You cannot be qualified as a man or a woman if you are subject to white supremacy racism. Is that logical to you, or is that something that you don't think is logical?
I don't agree with it.
Okay. What do you mean when you use the term man or woman?
I think of the part when you had the 60s and the person was saying, I am a man. People did the play cards and they had the cards saying, I am a man. I think saying that you are a man or a woman in that term, in that struggle term to me, because I'm 63 years old, that's stating that you have self-dignity and you will not be treated anything less than a man. So I disagree with Mr. Fuller on that.
Have a definition for what one has to do to qualify to be a man? Like, these are the things... Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, no. Go ahead.
I, if you were going to go ahead, if you got it, you heard the question, you can go ahead and respond.
No, I'll let you finish.
Definition for a man, like, these are specific things that you have to be able to do, or specific things that you do not do in order to meet that qualification. This is a man. And or if you want to give us, this is a woman, same thing.
I would say to be a man, you have to be out here doing a struggle, doing the best that you can under white supremacy. That doesn't stop you from being a man. Doesn't stop you from being a woman by raising your kids the best that you can, seeing that they have an education. I'm not just going by the white person standards of what manhood. They may be running the world, but that doesn't make them men or women. That makes them sick people that feel inferior. They have to call somebody else boy and that type of thing. So I think even in my interpretation, my assessment, I think in this system of white supremacy racism, you can still be a man or a woman. That's just my view.
Much obliged. Thank you for answering the question. I will assume folks are good. Star 61. I didn't see any other hands. 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61. I'll give you a few more seconds if you have a question that you want to get in. Any of the folks that have a hand up, did you have a question? Anything else you needed to get in?
Can I say something?
Did you have a question in Mondesi?
Yes, sir. Well, when you read that that segment, Mr. Gus, about well, let me direct it to the guests. So, Mr. Gus read a section of your book that was talking about having some type of relationship with people in Africa, black people in Africa, and that possibly helping out black Americans' situation. And maybe that would, I think you were saying maybe that would end white supremacy if we built the correct relationship with Africans on the continent. I think that's what the passage was saying. But then, if I remember correctly, what you verbalized was that we need to have dual citizenship. Well, yeah, we need to have dual citizenship in different areas. And I would just, like, from my experience, I don't know that to be an option. I've been to Ghana. I've searched the laws very thoroughly. I've spoken to a lot of people. And I just wonder, do you know of any cases where a number of black Americans have been able to get dual citizenship in another country full of black people?
I would say check Ghana on YouTube recently, too. There are African Americans that are going over there recently. If you put a pull up even on YouTube, African Americans living in Ghana. I've even off of YouTube been able to pull up certain things they talk about when they get over there, though there's just a different culture type of thing. as far as having your own,
if you could,
when you go out, just used to America, I would say. I would encourage anybody that is black to get yourself a passport. When you can, look at different places, save some money up and travel different places so you can see different parts of the world. I was fortunate enough for when I worked and for Delta Airlines for 10 years, I was able to fly free and just see all of Central America and look at their prisons down there compared to here and just talk to the people and learn a lot what they think of this country and how they view old people. I got a real good education about how people in other people countries treat their old people and how they're treated here.
Yes, sir. And I just to follow up with the question I asked, because I wanted to focus on the dual citizenship, and yes. Is that even a possibility? And I'm saying, have you actually heard of black Americans being able to get dual citizenship? Because I'm saying that it's not a possibility, and even if it is a possibility, the hardship that you have to go through, I just wonder, do you know of some place that's actually offering dual citizenship?
People don't have $100,000.
Yes, sir, and I'm not an expert by any means. I just a question. Thank you.
No, I appreciate the input.
Still learning. Still learning. Say that one more time. So
I had one more question. Gus.
Thomas in New York says another one.
Sure.
Now this is back to the community. And it was a hard pill for me to swallow as well. But when you said that in the place that you reside, You guys implemented a curfew for children?
Yes, sir.
Now, just to take it on, like, you know, how broad the system is, I live in Harlem. That would be impossible. And in fact, the only people that could implement something like that would be white people to put a curfew on 300-something thousand families, you know, like it'll be pretty, you know, in a 40-block radius. I mean, who else could police that? In a place like we have a Jewish community, they have the cops have the Star of David on the side of the car, the ambulances. Mm-hmm. They go to Beth Israel, Mount Sinai, one of their hospitals. Their own nursing centers, like they have a total community. We don't have that at all. We get sick, we call them. If we have a problem, we call their police. Like, do you see the difference, like, in having a community and pretty much, like Gus said, being in greater confinement where everything you need, you have to call the very people doing it to you to fix the problem?
That's a good point, sir.
Much obliged, Thomas in New York. Do you remember the portion in Mr. Fuller's book where he said white people are the smartest in the known universe? Do you remember that portion of the code book?
Yes.
Do you think that's true?
Logically speaking, I would say at this time it's accurate.
Okay. Just checking. Let's see. All right. I think folks are satisfied. Didn't see any other hands. Again, the book, Georgia's Corrupt Prison System, as told by an insider. We have chatted with Mr. Martin Dandridge, author of The Text. Hope it was a constructive exchange. I reckon if you write any other tidbits that are related to racism, white supremacy, let us know. You said you don't do a whole lot of radio hanging out and calling in or what have you, so hopefully.
Yeah, sometimes I'm not able to get you on the phone. My little flip phone doesn't work, but a lot of times I will email and stuff because I remember you reading a incident that I wrote about
working for the Georgia Department of Labor, and I was still trained there. So if I do come up with something, I'll just email in like I did that time. That seemed to be a better, effective way of communicating.
Okie dokie. That is common where people say that they have difficulties. There's some sort of interference being able to dial in. I think, who is it, Draftomania and some other folks were talking about they either will be able to connect, but they get disconnected at a certain point, like a 2-hour point. I think Be in Toronto had reported problems. It's 11 years. There have been some things that have been consistent. That is one. Phone interference, widespread. Gus T included. Glad we were able to get you. You can drop an email if you have contributions for workplace racism. You maybe can remember some things. We will be in touch. The book, you all can check it out, Georgia's Corrupt Prison System, as told by an insider. Enjoy the rest of your evening, Mr. Dandridge.
Okay, you take care too, Gus.
I will do my best. Be well, Mr. Dandridge.
You too.
Context of White Supremacy. Reading is more important than watching television will be here Thursday. Harriet A. Washington, A Terrible Thing to Waste. Whew. She might have two books in my top 10. That is, or at least I think that is amazing. I did not start out reading that book thinking, oh yeah, I'm going to have another book in my top 10, even though I was excited, like Harriet A. Washington, brilliant scholarship, but wow, I have been so impressed, and we've only read like 3 chapters, I think. Maybe, no, yeah, 3 chapters, about 3 chapters. Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, the COW's Toronto Yoga Retreat. One thing you can do with a nifty new passport. Toronto, May 21 through May 24, yoga, counter-racist workshops, plant-based meals. I might have to make my vegan lasagna. Wow, we had veggie lasagna, vegan lasagna at the Florida yoga retreat. It was delish. I did not make it. Chef Nadira did everything except the sweet potato pie and a few other things. I made cookies and a few other things, but she did the bulk of the cooking, like 90%, maybe 95%. But I did make sweet potato pie. I had thought of making that signature dish for the context of white supremacy, the sweet potato pie. But I mean, it'll be spring by, you know, late May. So there should be fresh blueberries. We could do blueberry cobbler, I was thinking. So, yeah, I don't know. We might... blueberry cobbler, and I was also thinking red velvet cake. Vegan red velvet cake. Whew. May 21 through May 24. Looking forward. Yummy eats. Yoga every day. Counter-racist workshops. Food workshops. Chef Nadira doing amazing work in the kitchen again. Gus T doing a little cooking as well. Drop an email if you would like information. Details. Veggie lasagna, made it over the weekend. Spectacular. Used lentils instead of ground beef, or they got all the imitation meat. Lentils was absolute. I took pictures. I posted it on the Facebook page. Tofu ricotta. It's tofu cashew ricotta cheese. Best lasagna I've ever had, meat or no, like not even close, like wow, just wow. I'll have to make it at the retreat, I think. Have to make it at the retreat. Anyway, program for today, people can let me know if they felt Gus T was discourteous or rude. But they can, you know, let me know if they felt I was discourteous or rude with our guest. I hope it is not conveyed that everybody needs to sound identical to Neely Fuller Jr. Like everybody has to come out and say, still learning. That's how you have to answer the phone. everybody every, you know, 5 minutes has to pause and say, if you don't understand racism, white supremacy, everything, it is not that at all. You have a brain computer. Use it. We are not going to all come to the same conclusion about white supremacy racism. I have not come to the same conclusion about racism, white supremacy as any other victim in the known universe, past, present, future. So it's not about getting consensus about anything. It is about following logic. That is really the hallmark, the essence of Neely Fuller Jr. Follow logic. Racists do many, many things to get us to be very illogical in our thinking and day-to-day activities and how we use our time and energy. That's what I said about that Super Bowl, man. If we're in a system of racism, white supremacy, if we are in greater confinement, then how valuable is that Super Bowl? Just using logic as we, you know, try to counter racist logic, you know, the essence of Mr. Fuller. And so I evaluate, you know, anybody really, just the use of terms. Are they following logic? Are they being accurate? They're a part of being logical is correct use of words. When you use words in an accurate manner, even sometimes down to the grammar, that has a way of pulling your mind to think in a more logical direction. Now, I could be talking totally crazy, but that is my conclusion. When you start to be a little bit imprecise, start being sloppier with how we articulate our thoughts, you start to have less precise thinking, less precise understanding about a concept or a problem. You start to lose some of the definition, the clarity. With racism, white supremacy, we need high definition, precision. That is a huge part of the problem. We are articulating a lot of times our frustration, our emotion about things, but we are not articulating what this problem is in a logical manner. That's why racists, they give us all these nonsense terms, racial bias and racial prejudice. That's in the book regularly, racial prejudice. Generally, what would happen if it's a non-white person and they write a book about racism, white supremacy? That's what I expect. The context of white supremacy is about having white guests on the program. That's what I've said for years. I tell people that when they make recommendations for the program, this platform was designed to talk to white people. That is what Counter Racism Code is for. Certainly, there are non-white people who have constructive information, but that's not really the primary focus of what this here broadcast is about. Using counter-racist logic to try to articulate our thoughts and views correctly. It's not about, you know, parroting just because Mr. Fuller said that there's no community. Now, you know, all right, we never say community again. It's broader than that. It's about what do we mean when we say that? Why are we even using that word community to describe, if we are in greater confinement, people who are just in a spacier prison? If that's what we have, if Mumia Abu-Jamal doesn't qualify to be in a community, just because you have more space does not mean that you're in a community. Just because you have a toilet with a door on it does not mean you are in a community. Just because you got ample toilet paper does not mean you are in a community. If you are in the system of racism, white supremacy, particularly if you can end up being in a cell next to Mumia in about 5 seconds, oh yeah. Yeah. That's what I mean. Because a lot of times, using these terms, it undermines, wait a minute, we are in a system of white supremacy. Like, the totality, the all-encompassing nature of that begins to be undermined when you come back and start thinking that, oh, we have a black community. We have black leaders. That's in the book, too. We have black men. black women. And it just goes on from there. All of that's in the book. And like I said, all of this is very common. And it wouldn't be, I wouldn't even be saying all of this. We probably just wouldn't have had this program. But people that mention Mr. Fuller and say, oh yeah, I've read his work and have been greatly influenced by it. And then that's not reflected like at all. I just scratched my head. Like, did you really read the text? Have you forgotten it? He said he read Mr. Fuller's work 30 years ago. Maybe you forgot. I don't remember everything that I, you know, read like 30 days ago. So, I mean, you know, sometimes we forget things. Sometimes you have to read material more than once and think on it and then rethink on it and then rethink on it, particularly if it is, you know, a substantial shift in the way that you have been thinking about a concept or verbalizing a concept. Sometimes it might take a lot of conscious, deliberate effort to change that. And again, as I said, this is not, you know, just, you got to say it exactly. You know, we're all going to repeat it together. That's not what this is at all. I hope, you know, I've done my best as a greatly retarded victim to articulate that. This is at its core about following logic. Following logic. And having some level of precision when we talk about racism, white supremacy. Like, these words were chosen carefully for a reason, hopefully chosen to maximize my ability to speak accurately, logically, to convey my thoughts so that people will efficiently understand what I'm saying, accurately understand what I'm saying, and I'm communicating using counter-racist logic. Communicating information that makes sense for the reality that we are in a system worldwide of white supremacy racism. Hopefully that's the way that we are choosing what words to use, what words not to use, not just saying, you know, what people have been saying for a long time. The black community, brothers and sisters, like I said, folks can let me know if they felt I was rude. I will say, we'll take a quick commercial break. If there is a black person, you have written constructive content, probably do not request to be a guest on the Cows. If it's constructive, like if I was talking to The People Could Fly, that's a constructive book. So if, you know, podcasting and you have, you know, at least 10 people listening, you will start to get, you know, emails from lots of different people. Some of them you know, some of them you don't know. So to get emails that have no information at all, just a link to something, two thumbs down. There should at least be some explanation as to what this is, why this is important, why I should care about this, or why you think this relates to my interest. That, I think, is generally helpful, especially when it's coming from someone who is probably a stranger. But the scrutiny with this work, like I said, people, when they request to be guests on the program, I generally am very suspicious because of the 11-year history of the Cows. If someone did have constructive information, I would recommend just saying, check this here book out. I don't know. Maybe you'll think it's constructive. You can check it out and let me know. That would be about it. No. Have me on to discuss such and such and such and such or whatever. Like, all of that I generally look at with, uh-oh, this is going to be like all the other times over the past 11 years. Like, or at minimum, the bar goes up very, very high just because of the history of what has happened with people requesting. Anywho, Virginia Hamilton, The People Could Fly is phenomenal. If you have children, it should definitely be in your library. It's phenomenal. The People Could Fly. I'll take a quick little break snippet, and then if folks have any thoughts, comments on Mr. Dandridge, what they heard, we'll take a time, take a moment for that. Quick little break with Mr. Fuller, and then we'll be right back. Context of White Supremacy.
Got another term on there, VGQ. What does that mean? Victims Guaranteed Qualification. Now, that keeps you from getting in arguments with other black people, particularly on television, which I get sick of that. Black people shouting, you know, we get into our ghetto thing once we get on television and get wound up, and we start all yelling at once. And the racists sit there smugly and just look. They watch the tennis match, so to speak. Right. And black people are shouting each other down, talking about, you don't know what you're talking about, and so and so and so and so, and we go into our Amos and Andy and Sapphire Act. Okay. VGQ means victims guaranteed qualification. Guaranteed qualification to do what? To give your opinion on anything about race. Don't care what it is. If you're on there with Minister Farrakhan, or you're on there with Mike Tyson, or you're on there with Miss, what's her name, Williams, the lady that had him put in, you know, recommended that he be put in jail, or you're on there with anybody. See, don't cut the other black person down. Now, I don't even like that term, brother and sister, even though it's been around for about 30 years. But I ain't going to talk about the brother here. And, you know, no. See, we haven't reached that stage where we can do that. See, we got to crawl before we walk, but we don't miss any steps. Don't say you are what you're not. Don't say you feel something that you don't really feel. You don't really feel that he's a brother. I usually use the expression, I don't like anybody in here. I say that to all audiences. I haven't been taught to like anybody. I've been taught to dislike people. I've been taught that. And then they're taught to dislike me, so it's just compounded disliking. I haven't even got to love yet. All right? So what we do is minimize conflict. Try not to hurt each other. So a certain thing, that's what a code is for. It's a stopgap. It keeps me from saying something against you. You say, well, don't you agree with what this person just said down here on the other end and whatnot? That person has VGQ, Mr. Donahue. I keep using him because he's one of the most prominent TV people. Right? But the main thing you do is try to stay off of a radio program or TV program or even a neighborhood stage program, you might say, where you spend your time shouting back and forth at other black people. Nothing is getting done there. And when it's done on television, a lot of black people just get up from the TV set and go on in the kitchen somewhere once that shouting starts. Yeah, they get disgusted. Say, you know, they say, oh, here we go. They started off okay, but now they're doing a job on each other, and I don't even want to hear it. So just don't do it. And you cut it off. The cutoff point is that person has victims guaranteed qualification. You spell it out what it means. Meaning the person can say anything about race that they want to, and I can say anything about it that I want to. You are guaranteed that. You earn that as a victim. Simply by being a victim. Now, if a white person says something, that's something else.
Something else entirely. Always great to get that in case people are not familiar with that acronym as well. VGQ, Victims Guaranteed Qualified. With that, we'll be here on Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific for the book club. Folks can share. Again, if you have any thoughts on what we heard from Mr. Dandridge, I think I said pretty explicitly, no endorsement from Gus T Renegade on this book. I did not enjoy it at all. There are many, 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 many books on prisons, because there are many, 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 many prisons in the system of white supremacy, and probably more books coming. There are better books you could read about prisons. Slavery by Another Name, much better book you could read about prisons in Georgia specifically, if you are so inclined. Douglas Blackman, guest on the program before. Any folks, observations, thoughts, comments they would like to share?
I meant to ask about leaders. I was going to ask him if there was any black people that he would follow in a system of white supremacy, you know? I think that he did have a code where he didn't deal with the white spouses of his siblings, which, you know, he was operating off a code. I just think that some of the, like you said, the logic was just a bit off. I didn't read the book
and it doesn't seem like the type of book I would, want to read a prison story, or someone's, I think I've seen enough of the results of that, over my years. I don't really need to, unless it's some information that's going on that no one knew before, but I think that the guest is, he was just, confused on some of the logic points that you were making, you were trying to bring forth. The community thing, like, I had a hard time with it, but it's accurate. And, I just would love to know, who would he follow? Like, every leader, supposedly, that white people have told us that this is your leader, they've killed them, or something's happened to them where they've been arrested or had their name tarnished in some way, including some of the heroes, the sport heroes or whatever, detained or that. Any time they want to, they can take you right off of your pedestal that they gave you and end up like Mr. Simpson. And it was strange, Gus, because I don't think Mr. Firefighter knew you had a show last night, so I texted him this morning, and he was kind of, I think, like, you had a show? Oh, man. But either way, Mr. Mahomes, man, he has, I've noticed that black men, and I mean, he's black, have the most terrible taste in white women I've ever seen. It seems like when I see white men, who's the star quarterback, and Tom Brady, he's married to a supermodel. I mean, this guy's married to, I was like, ugh, and I could just go down the list of black men with some terrible look. Like, I don't even see white men who are on their same level taking a second look at these white women anyway. I don't know. I'll mute my line, Gus. Thank you.
She's white, system of racism, white supremacy. That goes a long, 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 long way. Just got to try to solve the problem. Feverish Patrick Mahomes, feverish. He might have a white parent. I don't know a whole lot about Patrick Mahomes. I don't know if he has a white parent or not, but regardless.
He has a white mother, and his father was a professional athlete who played baseball for the New York Mets.
Oh, okay, yeah. I thought he had a white parent, but I wasn't for certain. I think I paid a little bit more attention when Colin Kaepernick was in the Super Bowl. Like, I remember seeing his adopted parents, and then I remember even seeing his white mother as well. Like, I paid the Seahawks and all that. Like, I remember paying a lot more attention both when they played him in the conference final and when Mr. Kaepernick was in the Super Bowl. So I got to see a lot of him, and I paid a lot of attention. I didn't see as much of that with Mr. Mahomes, but yes, victim of racism. Yeah, victim of racism. What can you say? BGQ. Tragic arrangement. Sad. Very sad. Any other observations, folks, comments they wanted to get in, what they heard from Mr. Dandridge?
Yes, sir. Can I be heard?
Imhan DC?
Yes, sir. Thank you. The comment, again, about black people being able to get dual citizenship in another country where there are other black people, I think this is a very serious matter that please don't give incorrect information that there's some black country allowing black Americans to get dual citizenship. I've heard so many times people say information against what I'm understanding, what I've researched and what I've gone and experienced. I'm still traumatized by some of the things that have happened while I was in Ghana. I mean, I just hope I won't say it on the air. Although I was treated correctly in many aspects, I'm not going to. So, I've heard people on Sinetta's program give incorrect information about black Americans allowed to get citizenship at this place or that place, and I find it to be not true. But it's dangerous to give black people incorrect information like that. I mean, it's really dangerous. And even in my opinion, my strong opinion. And my mother was showing me today an article saying that Ghana's currency is the most competitive in the world against the American dollar, something along those lines. This year is the most competitive of all the countries against the American dollar. But I say that's because last year they gave this false notion that they were asking black Americans to return to Ghana. But they weren't asking black Americans to return to Ghana, but black Americans did go and tour. When black Americans do things, we usually make it better for other individuals. But I don't see what the benefit for the black Americans were. Like I said before, they kept using, when I went to all the events, the return to Ghana events, because I was in Ghana at the time, they were using the name of black Americans, as in the group of black Americans, just for publicity and giving all the benefits to Ghanaians who just left 30 years ago or 50 years ago. I mean, I'm telling you, it's dangerous. I can't explain exactly how, but it is dangerous to give this type of incorrect information that there is some type of safe haven for us. Thank you.
Strive for accuracy. That is always best, to just get, you know, correct information about what things are. I certainly would not want to. I don't like traveling, you know, a block from my residence and being confused about what the procedure is going to be or what the sale is at the grocery store. And, you know, if I thought the bananas were going to be 90 cents a pound and I get there and they're a dollar a pound, I'm traumatized. So, I mean, to go halfway across the globe and think that you have citizenship and then get there and know that is not the case, like, oh man, and the implications of that, or you can get citizenship, but, you know, you have to pay us, $50,000 U.S. or something of that. And I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Or at least you want to know that going. Correct information, like strive for accuracy. Correct information. The system of white supremacy often deliberately makes it difficult for black people to get accurate information at the time they need it. That is hallmark of this system, to get the information like 20 years too late. Oh, man, it's just known, and that's what that is considered. Hurricane Katrina. Oh, man. There were buses right there. Oh, if we imagine the lives. Oh, well. Consistent. Getting accurate information at the time that you need it. Strive for accuracy. Really, that's what I mean about, you know, precision with words. All of that is changing, a part of changing that, a part of why so many of us think it's not going to happen in our lifetime. It's going to take, you know, a billion years, you know, maybe 500 million years if we get lucky, changing how we talk about this problem. That's why Dr. Wellson talked about having a definition for white supremacy racism and then being accurate, precise with our words. That right there is leaning towards accuracy. Getting lots of accurate information so that we can be more informed, make logical, informed decisions, and then precision with the way that we articulate. Choose, you know, whichever words you think will best articulate your views. But again, choosing words that will accurately reveal truth using counter-racist logic. Anything else folks want to get in, what they heard from Mr. Dandridge or any other observations, thoughts to share? Sorry, retired fire, missed out on the broadcast. I was working feverishly. I was working feverishly Sunday in preparation for the counter-racist broadcast, counter-racism broadcast during the Super Bowl. So I did not have time. I was undecided. I wasn't even conclusive about whether we were going to do the program because I said, oh, man, we got to prepare for this program. And I was still trying to finish up reading Mr. Dandridge's book, which I did not enjoy. Could have propped my feet up, watched Patrick Mahomes win the MVP, or at least, you know, been had less to do in preparation for the broadcast yesterday. But I didn't decide until late in the day, late for me, for the broadcast. So I guess that's how retired firefighter missed out, because I was ambiguous about it on the compensatory call-in this past Saturday. It is archived, so people can go back and check it out, see if they saw any of the commercials. We started off the program today with the promo from Donald Trump that I heard yesterday. I was able to go back and actually see it for the first time once we got off the air. But, yeah. Any other comments, observations from folks that are with us? Star 6-1. Grant, I will assume folks are all satisfied. We should be here, as I said, Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Harriet A. Washington, a terrible thing to waste. Excellent reading. I'm super enjoying. With that, again, I hope we didn't call. Nobody was calling Mr. Dandridge names or anything. He stayed and hung out. I think if we had been nasty and hostile, he would have probably exited. So certainly was not my intention to be nasty and hostile, but I did think it was important to use logic, something we have been striving for 11 years. Use logic in evaluating our problems and, you know, at least minimums, reconsider, you know, what exactly is a community in a system of white supremacy? What does that mean? Why am I saying that I'm a part of a community? Am I? Just, you know, begin to think a little bit. We talked about that this weekend. We had the black father dialed in or wrote in. He was talking about, you know, trying to take care of his child, and the white teacher was mistreating him and just devaluing his education. And he said he felt like a failure as a parent. I said, Mr. Fuller, there's a reason he says we are attempted parents. We just can't be, you know, the high-quality mothers and fathers that we would like to be in a system of white supremacy. It's just not possible. That's, you know, just following logic. Painful it should be. That should motivate us to solve this problem if we really want to be all-star mothers and fathers. Talking about Kobe Bryant. Can't be all-star father, system of white supremacy, even if you got a lot of money. Anywho, just think about that. That's, you know, Mr. Dandridge, he quotes Mr. Fuller. That's what Mr. Fuller is about. Think about the words that we are using. Not dictatorial, not about parroting, just using counter-racist logic. Racists do a phenomenal job at feeding us incorrect terms and metaphors and ways of verbalizing their terrorism of black people. It is the beginning of knowledge to call things by their proper name. Strive for accuracy, efficiency, and some counter-racist logic when we talk, write, speak about racism. With that, sobriety would be best. I hope everybody is, you know, it's Tuesday now, basically, so no excuse. Even if you're in Kansas City, you know, you can go to the parade on Wednesday and be sober, certainly. Go to the parade, behave, and then it'll be black to a normal day on the plantation on Thursday. So be sober, thinking clearly so that you can use logic. In addition to being sober, let's be buckled up if you are in a vehicle, passenger or driver, even if I guess it's driverless. Or doing all the little things that we can to try to stay as safe as possible under conditions of white supremacy. In addition to being sober and buckled up, if you're driving, you are not on the cell phone, just trying to make sure we do not come in contact with the Daniel Holtzclaws and Amber Geigers of the known universe. Keep us out of greater confinement. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, your brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.